Welcome again from my side to the user meeting part of this conference. And I do not have as many slides also as normally, so I would like to have discuss a few things. Let me start. So first, I just start with an animation that pretty much summarizes a lot of the things that have been going on in the past year and also where we are today. So this is a simulation of a galaxy, as you see. I guess everybody in here recognizes this. And it is this bonsai code, and it was one of the finalists of last year's Gordon Bell competition at supercomputing. And the relevance why I show this, apart from being a big application and a good work that is being done on the machine on Pitts 9, this is a movie that was taken during SC. So this simulation, at the time when we were looking at these frames, we were standing in New Orleans, and the simulation was running at that time on 1,000 nodes on Pitts 9, and the rendering was happening on the same nodes, or on the machine. So the data never left the machine, never left the memory. And what this basically means is, yes, we have a capability to do in situ visualization, and in principle we can even now do interactive supercomputing, like what people always talk about. But I think there is a more general relevance, namely, if you can render data, you can do any analysis on the data while the simulation is running. And I believe that this is one of the very important things that we should be working towards in the future, to change the workflow from we simulate, we write out data, and then maybe later we will analyze the data, to actually doing much more, writing out checkpoints, redoing the simulation, analyzing the simulation, changing the analysis, and so on. So this is a type of capability I believe that's going to develop in the coming years, and I think this is a first proof of principle that this is possible. And you will hear, also when you talk to the CSCS staff, we do have now integrated, this was one of the big achievements with introducing PITSDORA last fall, integrated visualization into Pitts 9, pre and post processing of into PITSDORA. So the CREXC systems at CSCS now cover the entire range of the workflow, including the coupling to storage, which will be very important for projects like Marvel and so on. Good. Now, in terms of evolution of the user lab, just quickly to put this into context, this is, by the way, a slide I presented last year, so I can show how we evolve from what we discussed last year. We started in 2009 with HPCN, that led to the investment in Monte Rosa and HP2C, which is the predecessor of the PASC program, so application development, which then motivated the upgrade of the machine Monte Rosa. And Monte Rosa we decommissioned, as most of you who are users of CSCS know, in the spring of this year, so just a few months ago. Then we had this investment into data storage and analysis platform, Eureka, and I know a number of communities from CSCS benefit from this data storage and also contribute to this. We then had the Pitts 9, the initial, and then the upgrade that were all application driven. Then we extended the funding, or got the funding extended, and that funded PASC, which is now also supporting this conference. So this whole application driven development continued, and PASC will eventually, we had PITSDORA, so I need to go in sequence here, the transformation that we are making, like we did with PITSDORA, is really the green, the color coding is important. While in the past, data analysis and storage were separated from the HPC, now everything is basically converging into one platform. And I think this is really an important development, that we can support data science and we can support HPC in the future. And we can support the diversity of workflows. That's what we are working towards. PASC, of course, the PASC projects are going to motivate the upgrade technically that is planned for the second half of next year. This, you know, decisions about this will be happening in the fall of this year. At this point, it is still too early to commit to any particular details. The very important thing that I really, this is, you know, looking forward. We had, a year ago, we have written this proposal. We were asked to write a proposal to continue HPCN beyond 2016. And this proposal was part of the Swiss research infrastructure or science infrastructure roadmap. It was reviewed by the Swiss National Science Foundation, and it received an A rating. So this is basically puts ETH domain on a track to continue this project, and it has been externally reviewed. So I think everything is on a proper track here. We did receive the recommendation to coordinate with various cloud computing projects that were also proposed, and also at the request of formerly Swiss University Conference, but now it's called Swiss University, we were also asked to help the universities with their institutional clusters. And so this has been also integrated into this initiative in the future. And in the case of University of Zurich, they are already participating in PITSTORA with support from the PASC program. And then, of course, it is HPCN 2.0 that will eventually fund the successor to the CREXE platform. Of course, here we have no idea what this will be at this point, but we still have to plan it from a funding point of view. And we also, and this is the important news, whether it's under the same name, I like the name, I like input, to hear input. This initiative on investment in software and application development will continue as well, and it will be again integrated with HPCN 2.0. So from that point of view, things will stay the same programmatically, okay? From a technical point of view, there are a few changes. One change is PRACE. So I've added this as an additional layer. This is the partnership of advanced computing in Europe, of which CSIS has been a general partner. And in the past, PRACE had a number of four hosting partners that would host large systems, and that scientists in Europe can write proposals against. And so PRACE is, the first phase is ending or has ended, and the PRACE 2, the next phase is going to start sometime in the next, so there is a transition period going on. And of course, what has happened since the beginning of PRACE? Well, this machine turns out to be still the most performant supercomputer in Europe, and it is not the PRACE Tier 0 system. So people have been asking. On the other side, Swiss users, there are probably people in here who are users of the PRACE Tier 0 systems in Europe. And so I think it is quite obvious also from when you look at the importance of science that Switzerland make a contribution, and that we will participate with PITSTEINT or a fraction of PITSTEINT in PRACE 2. Now, what does this mean? I think from an operational point of view of Bitstein, it will just be, things will continue. Because what we will do, or what we propose to do, is to move what are today the Kronos allocations, so the very large allocations, that we, instead of having them under our own review process, that we move Kronos allocations to the PRACE review process. And the advantage, I believe, that really, so from that point of view, nothing changes for us. You know, the recommendation, there will be another review process that will feed into our, ultimately, the panel, scientific advisory committee of CSIS will get this input and will just consider the input just in the same way that the peer review so far was considered as input. But I think there is a huge advantage for Swiss scientists. For European scientists, it stays the same. And for Swiss scientists, is that they will be encouraged also really explicitly to go for allocations on other PRACE Tier 0 systems. Okay, so you will have not just the PASC project, not just the Kronos call to work against and Bitstein, but also the other Tier 0 systems that you can propose against. And I believe this is an important development because you will have a diversity of architectures for the largest systems. But I would like to hear feedback. Now, if you have spontaneous opinions or so, I'm happy to take questions or feedback now. But I'm also happy to hear feedback, you know, in the breaks or also, you know, doesn't have to be today or tomorrow. But you had a, could you take the microphone?
I have two questions concerning PRACE and Kronos entering into, Kronos being the allocation for PRACE. Kronos, if I remember well, is an allocation lasting for 3 years, while PRACE is strictly 1 year. So this makes a difference from the user point of view.
Yes, and so second, PRACE currently, can I just answer? Sure. This, what you're talking about are the current PRACE allocations. For us to participate in PRACE, there will have to be certain conditions that have to be met. So this is under development. And multi-year allocations, I don't know if Petros is here, Petros Komoutsakos, because he's co-chair of the Scientific Steering Committee, and multi-year allocations in PRACE are being discussed. And I believe, I explicitly didn't want to write anything not to get in trouble. I get always in trouble, but the... So this is being discussed, okay? There's a lot of things that are being discussed also. And considered, yeah. You can already have multi-year projects, so thank you.
Nowadays you can have a kind of renewal.
But same with Kronos.
Sorry?
Same with Kronos.
No, I meant that under PRACE nowadays you can have a second allocation, but that's a kind of new project you submit. But if okay. It's many years, it's completely different, it's much more interesting, much more appealing.
Okay. No, so we are, just to reiterate this point, there are a few things. I think the PRACE review process is actually very good, has a high standard, and it's a standard comparable to ours. So from that point of view, there are a few formalities that I will ask that they change to make it, because I'm not going to compromise on our standard. Okay, that's okay. But thank you for the question. And I don't know if there's other spontaneous points. Otherwise, go ahead.
So will the decision of these projects lie with the PRACE Access Committee, or will it be CSCS that still decides who gets the allocation?
So this is a formality that we are working out, how exactly we do this. But that's again one of my conditions, that because this is a political condition that I have in Switzerland, that Ralf Eichler, who we will talk about tonight, said basically, you know, whatever your process is, in the end, you, that means me, I am, or whoever is the director of CSCS, is responsible. So I am not going to let somebody else decide if I'm responsible for the decision. So in the end, it's my decision, and in the end, it's my, because I don't know if everybody is familiar how it works here, but in our case, we have the, you submit proposals, and then we have a process that reviews the proposals, and then the reviews are discussed by the scientific advisory committee. And it's scientific advisors that we have that are well-known external people. Two of them are in the PRACE scientific steering committee. They give the advice to me, and I usually follow that advice. And so the way I see it is the PRACE will then basically, the review will feed into this. So they have their own panels, and I think they work very well. That will feed into this. But in the end, it's the scientific advisors who give me the recommendation. So that will be the same. But thanks for the question. And I want to really encourage you, if there's concerns you have or ideas, or so that you bring them up and you discuss them with me. Okay, so the last part of the talk, I am going to try to look into the future as much as we can in this business. And I will do this by putting up a slide that I may have shown here. It's a picture I took from Raj Hasra's talk, who is the head today, head of HPC at Intel. And it was given at SOS 14, so in March 2010. And this was about Moore's Law and, you know, the Intel TikTok process and how they are improving the process, shrinking every 2 years and improving the architecture every 2 years. This, the interesting thing is, this was in 2010, and now we are here, between 14 and 16, okay? And what we know, the good thing about being here and not in 2010 is we can look back and see what really happened, okay? And interestingly, you know, we know Sandy Bridge was 32 nanometer, was a new architecture, and that was around probably 11, 12. We introduced it in 12, probably 11, 12, okay? So that was here. We know that this one, 22 nanometer, was Ivy Bridge, came in 13. Okay, that was, I think, EPCC introduced an Ivy Bridge system. And so we know it's delayed, but the other data point is that the Broadwell, 16 nanometer, will come next year. Okay, so that's 2 years delayed. And I think there is in this, there is a message. This is not just because of Intel, marketing or something. What you see in reality, what is happening is, as we move to smaller and smaller numbers here, and my colleagues in material science know that at some point, you know, a PN junction is not a PN junction anymore when you go to atomic scales or so. So we are slowly reaching the limits of Moore's law. And this is, in fact, this is something that Moore himself predicted would happen sometime around 2020 and 2025. And this is something that now in 2015 we have to start worry about. Actually, I was at a very interesting workshop in Japan last December, and there was precisely a discussion of what happens, you know, at the dawn. I call it the dawn of Moore's Law. And I think there is a general agreement that maybe many, many things will happen, but there are two main things that will reset the priorities. One, it is that architectural diversity. And I believe what we see with GPUs now is the first step. Today we have two fundamentally different architectures, x86 or what some call conventional processors, and we have GPUs, and they are both valid architectures. And I'm pretty sure next year we will be talking at the user day about a third one. I'm almost certain. And so then we have already three. And this is, I think, is just a natural process of what is happening, because if Moore's law, if you don't have this exponential scaling, which any mistake you make, any inefficiency in the architecture becomes exponentially irrelevant, because the performance is going up anyway, but it starts to converge or to some asymptote and become constant, then suddenly it pays off to invest in architectures, because you can fix things and you will get the return on those investments. And this is what we see. We also know that Apple with the iPhones has, we have a number of candidates, also ARM eventually, and so that we will see in HPC. And this is real, okay? So this GPU thing is not just a luxury that we have in Switzerland. I think it's a confrontation with the reality. And then, of course, diversity in architecture will imply importance of software. And this is software at all layers, okay? Starting at the system software all the way up to application software. And this is why it is profoundly important that in Switzerland we continue this PASC program into the future, and as I reported before, I'm very confident that it will go into the future. And this also means, in my view, that we really have to think very seriously differently about how we develop applications. So the idea of developing a long spaghetti code in serial, and then somehow it will be open MPI'd or MPI'd, and so in the future, I don't think those things will be successful for too much longer. Rather, what we have really, we have this interaction between physical models, mathematical description, and algorithmic description. Discussions I had is both of these are mathematics. It's not that this is mathematics and this is computer science. It's computer science is in a sense a subfield of mathematics. And if you're a physicist, you will say it's everything is physics anyway. But I know a few people who agree with me on this one. But no, the important point is this is really what science is about these interactions of these three domains. And we need to make sure this is efficient. Of course, when we have settled on algorithms, we will still have to write some C or Fortran code. And this is what I call imperative code. We do have compilers that today are much more transparent than in the past, that you can actually, like LLVM or so, you can interact with different parts of the compiler. And the thing that is really, as I said before, profoundly new is we will have different architectures. And the important effect is that depending on the architecture we target, we need a different implementation, or we need even different algorithms. We see this today with Xeon and with GPUs, and this is going to continue. So the things we have started to invest in today, I think they will become more important as we reach the end of the decade. And when you look at this graph here, then it is obvious that there is one natural place to draw a separation line. And this is more a conceptual, this should not be a social line or so, but it's a conceptual line. And above this line is where we have science applications, which, and this is the intellectual step that we have to make. Science applications should really use a descriptive, dynamic developer environment. So ideally, this is something like MATLAB, okay, for the big, even for supercomputing applications. And this is then built on tools and libraries and programming environments, and they are not one for everything. They will be domain specific, and this is why you need multidisciplinary co-design of tools that has some domain scientists, but it has computer engineers, it has mathematicians and it has people who focus traditionally on HPC. And there is, of course, going to be somewhere a different line, you know, because at some point we use hardware that is commercial and, you know, that's coming from, you know, at some point it's proprietary and not open anymore. But it's very important that the upper part is open. One proposal that we are making is really this should go as far as running this a model inside of Python, IPython, a notebook, and then it looks like MATLAB. And the tools is like the equivalent of NumPy. When you have Python multiplying matrices, it's slow. But if you use NumPy arrays and the right implementation of NumPy for your architecture, it's as fast as BLAS. So we need the equivalent for stencils, for tensor products, or for various other any of the domains. And so I believe that future PASC projects really have to focus on developing tools like this. And we have one initial step already. We have a call out there for universities to look at the existing PASC projects that need additional support in tools development can write proposals now. And this is really a step in this direction, which I believe is where we need to go, and of course where we will also have interactions with other places on the hybrid side, with Japan and also US, and so this is of course a multidisciplinary but also multinational development. Okay, so that's pretty much what my opinion is of where the future will be and what we have to do to get ready. And I want to open the floor for discussions before we get to the next talk. You tell me how much time.
Yeah. Other questions for Thomas?
So as the hardware gets more diverse and say maybe more exotic, how can we make sure that these low-level libraries will be available at the time the production machines go up and that we can exploit them? I think this is a very important question. Yeah.
Very good question. And this is it's actually one of the very good discussions we are having with some of the vendors, be it Intel, NVIDIA, Cray, IBM, you know, those who have in the past written libraries. But it's very clear that one of the problems we have today is, you know, some of these scientific libraries, which are like BLAS, versions of BLAS or LAPACK, have a hard time keeping up with the architectures of the particular vendor that is developing these, and it's the true for almost all the vendors. So that I'm not even naming any names here, and this is a problem. Okay, and so this is why I think it is profoundly important that this here, including some of these scientific libraries that we use today, are based on an open source foundation. Okay. So that the community can participate in the development. And so my proposal is that we eventually build a consortium, multinational, international, that is supporting this part here. And you can still have commercial entities inside of that then may pick the cherries or may pick certain solutions that they can map onto architectures, and that may be a proprietary implementation. But what I don't like is that we get used to a library, we have this type of vendor lock-in that we can have today, okay? And then we are basically locked into that architecture. That, I think we should try to avoid, and we have to be very conscious about this. Thank you for the question. This is very important. Oops.
Yeah, I guess it's almost on the same lines, and it's, you know, how can we keep up innovation in working with the physical models and the algorithmic description if the effort starts to be, you know, beyond the intelligence of, you know, a bright 20-year-old that spends 4 years on a PhD. Mm-hmm. I'm sort of, you know, this is my concern. And I think I saw this in material science codes, that because we were driven, 10, 15 years ago by efficiency, and we went towards all these technologies like ultrasound, pseudopotential, MPAW, that, you know, they gave us efficiency, but they become so complex that then we weren't able to do many new developments. Yeah.
But remember, in the days when we were students, we were, I was working with these Green's function KKR codes, and the first codes I worked with when I was a PhD student, I implemented my own matrix multiplies, okay? And I even, you know, you start, that was initially on the Cray YMP, so you didn't have to worry about blocking because you had bandwidth that took you forever, you know, everywhere. And but then at some point you move it to your Apple workstation or Sun workstation, and then you start working about blocking and so on. And today we would not think about doing this by hand anymore. And I think it's this process that we have to make much more systematic. It somehow got stuck with linear algebra, maybe FFTs, okay, which happen to be, you know, those things that you have well known, or, you know, where there are good algorithms, but there are also very simple user interfaces. You know, there's not much you can do to mess up the user interface of the matrix multiply routine. And I think, for example, for stencils, the algorithms are not more complex. The math is not more complex than linear algebra. In fact, sometimes it's simpler. But why does the equivalent not exist? Because the user interface, the application interface, API, is much more complex. And this is why we need in here, you know, you will have, you need the language support to support more complex, what we now call domain-specific languages or libraries. So this has to be developed, and the interface to the more descriptive environment has to be properly maintained. And I think that's the only way how one of your PhD students can still develop a complex new mathematical, I don't know, in your case it will be some correlated, you know, extension of exchange correlation potentials or something like that, with all the numerical bells and whistles up here, and can rely on robust tools that we somehow have to develop. But I think the difference to in the past is the people who develop these things here, they do need contributions from people who come from your field. Okay? So I hope we will convince a fraction of the domain scientists to get interested in these developments and participate in the developments. Because if you leave this just to applied mathematicians, yeah, then you will get the more, you know, the things that can be very, very generic. You know, and then you still would have to do all your stuff yourself, and that cannot be. Okay, thank you. Good questions, and I will involve you in the thinking process.
Any other
What is your opinion about future design of HPC support in Switzerland?
So would HPC support?
HPC support in Switzerland on national level, should it go more towards big centers like CSCS? Or is there room for small clusters at every university and user lab, or you would be in favor of supporting really huge data centers and outsourcing basically to a proper place?
So the basis of the strategy that we run in Switzerland and that you should be now very familiar with is that what has happened is the infrastructure gets more and more centralized, and the application side, the software side, and also the expertise, how to develop applications, not just the upper part, but also some of this expertise here, okay? So don't miss out, this is not centralized, this is a decentralized, and I say even I stress, international development here. So the expertise for how to develop this and also the work will continue to be decentralized in Switzerland. You asked about clusters. I think we are not going to prescribe what happens with clusters. I've never done this in the past and I will never do it in the future. I think the market should decide. And you can see a trend, when you look at cloud computing, that I think what you see there is infrastructure gets more and more abstracted. And I believe you will see this also with computer centers. Maybe not at the next user meeting, but maybe I hope before I retire, the discussion is not about machines anymore in a room like this, but it should be about these tools, which I would then call is an HPC platform. Okay, and it abstracts the infrastructure. This is a trend that we see in these public clouds. You can have there, you can have data centers that are 10 times larger than in power, in performance, than CSCS. So places like CSCS will be federated with other places in Europe. This is why it's important that we have this PRACE development also, and hopefully if this all works well, the know-how is distributed at the universities. But there might still be good reasons why you want to build a cluster near an experiment, for example, or near some large data source that you need to do the analysis there. So I don't think you can make a general statement. There's a trend in IT or ICT, but there is also a real need in science. And where this is then ending up, how the solution will come, I don't want to predict. I think we'll be wrong anyway.
Okay, Thomas, thanks. I think we need to stop here. There will be time to talk to you also.
Yeah.